All right, Philippians chapter number 2. I want to just do something this morning that's a little different. We were, the last few weeks have been kind of interrupted in some of the things I was teaching before that in a little series, and next week we'll be at the conference, and the Sunday after that we'll just be putting life back together. So I thought this morning I'd just talk to you about something that I enjoy to talk about, and that's the Lord Jesus Christ. You know, our Savior is the celebrity of the universe. He's the most unique person of all time. Philippians chapter 2, the Apostle Paul tells you about that. Verse number 5, let this mind be in you, which is also in Christ Jesus. Here's the thinking process of grace. John 1 says, the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld His glory, even the glory of the Father, full of grace and truth. If you want to see who God is, you look at the Lord Jesus Christ, and you see that God's grace and God's truth. The mindset the Lord Jesus Christ had of grace, the mindset He had of the truth of God. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. Now He's going to describe it. Who, being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God. He's the second person of the Godhead. But made Himself of no reputation. He didn't say, I'm going to strut my deity. I'm going to strut around. I'm the second person of the Godhead. I'm the one whom the Father has all His confidence, the preeminence of the Father. He wants His Son to be preeminent in everything. He said, I'm not going to stand. Not robbery if I did that. But that's not the issue. The issue is the will of my Father. He made Himself of no reputation, not going to go on His own. Took upon Him the form of a servant and being found in likeness as a man. He became the God-man. And sometimes you hear people say he was fully God and fully man, and that's really not the way to say that. He was truly God and truly man. You can't be 100% two different things. But He was completely God, and He was also completely man. He was truly God and truly man. And being found in fashion as a man, He humbled Himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. He's the God-man. Now, I say he's unique. Nobody else in all of religion or philosophy has anybody like Him. You talk to an atheist, they don't have anybody. You talk to a Muslim, they deny the idea of the Trinity, the idea that Jesus Christ was God. They don't have a Savior. They just have this deity out there that you can't touch. If you talk to pagans, Hindus, my wife teaching in kindergarten has little children in the kindergarten, and sometimes a number of them parents are Hindus. And one of the little girls talks to my wife, and she says, I don't believe in your God. And Cynthia said, well, I do. And so she said, well, they talked about the Lord Jesus Christ and tell him about it, and said, I don't have a God like that. My God isn't like that. They're right. They're not. The uniqueness of the Lord Jesus Christ being man, not just God, but the God-man, takes part of our humanity. Titus chapter 2, Paul says, looking for the blessed hope and glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior, Jesus Christ. He's the great God and He's our Savior. He's our Savior because He became man. He's truly God and truly man. If you look at 1 Timothy chapter number 2, we defend the deity of Christ because people often attack it and question it. But you need to also understand that you need to defend and appreciate the humanity of Christ. That doesn't deny His deity, but He's the God-man. When you take two nouns and you put a hyphen, you make them one. He's the God. He's also the man. It's important to understand His humanity. 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 4. Talking about verse 3, God our Savior, who would have all men to be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth. For there is one God and one mediator between God and men, the man, Christ Jesus. Because He was the man, Christ Jesus, who gave Himself a ransom for all to be testified in due time. The fact that He was a man meant He could come and be a redeemer for you. He can take God by the hand because He's God, and He can take you by the hand because He's man, and He can be the mediator, the one that brings the two together. There's no way for you to get in touch with God except you have someone who is deity take your hand and bring you together. And when He went to Calvary, He did that to be the mediator between God and man. to be the one that settled the issue, brings us together. Hebrews chapter number 4. Hebrews 4, verse number 14. Seeing then that we have a great high priest that is passed into the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast our profession, for we have not an high priest that which cannot be touched with the feelings of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted like unto us, yet without sin. Did you ever have anybody tell you do something and you say, you don't know what you're talking about because you don't do what I do? Never lived in my feet. You know, you don't know me. You don't know what's going on in my life. The Lord Jesus Christ has been everything that you, everywhere you've been, tempted in all points like you are. His humanity was the same as your humanity, except he wasn't tainted by sin. He's tempted in all points. He was tested every way you've been. Every time you're tested, every time you're tempted, he's been there too. And he was without sin in your in our humanity. He's touched by the feelings of our infirmities. There's nothing you go through when the CNS gang comes and starts beating on you, and you think, "Wow, life has turned up, turned against me." Whatever you're going through, he's been there, and he went through it successfully, without any sin, without any failure. So you don't have a Savior who doesn't know. You have a Savior who's entered into the experiences of your life. And whether it's the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, the pride of life, that's the three ways you get tempted, tested. He's been there without sin. He's been successfully there. That's the uniqueness of who he is. Now, his humanity, you're in Hebrews, look at chapter 5. Verse number 6. So also Christ, chapter 5, Hebrews 5, 6. So also Christ glorified not himself to be made an high priest, but he hath he that saith unto him, Thou art my son, today have I begotten thee. As he saith in another place, Thou art a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. In other words, Christ didn't make himself a priest, God the Father did. God the Father gave him that responsibility. Who in the days of his flesh, when he had offered up prayers and supplications with strong crying and tears unto him that was able to save him from death and was heard in that he feared, though he were a son, yet he learned obedience by the things he suffered. Think about that. He's God the Son, the one who's sovereign, creates all things, and yet he learns. How does God learn something? If you learn something, you didn't know it previously. How can God, who has all knowledge of all things, how can he learn something he didn't know? He did that in his humanity. When he took upon his humanity, he lived in his humanity. Instead of exercising his deity attributes in that, he lived as God in our flesh. That's a great illustration, great example, how he lives in us now. When Paul... In the first session, Alex was going over 2 Corinthians chapter 4 about the faith of Christ. The Lord Jesus Christ in his humanity lived by faith in the will of his Father. That's why Galatians says, I'm crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live, yet the life that I now live, I live by the faith of the Son of God. I don't live it by me, I live it by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. I live, Christ's life in me operates the same way it operated in his flesh, by my faith, trusting the will of the Father. That's a wonderful thing. You see it in life, living reality. That's how you understand passages like Mark 13 people throw at you, where he says, no man knows the day or the hour, not even the Son. Now, how is it that Jesus Christ wouldn't know the day or the hour that he and the Father planned in eternity past? Because when he took on his humanity, he took upon the limitations that humanity has. He's the God who lives within our limitations as man. He humbled himself and became obedient unto death. He doesn't exercise his deity attributes on his own. You look over Hebrews chapter 10. When he comes into the world, Hebrews chapter 10, verse 5. Wherefore, when he cometh into the world, he saith, Sacrifice and offering thou wouldest not. He's quoting Psalm 40. but a body hast thou prepared me. In burnt offerings and sacrifices for sins thou hast no pleasure. Then said I, lo, I come, and the volume of a book it is written of me, to do thy will, O God. That's what Paul's talking about. He humbled himself and became obedient under the will of his Father. Became a servant, lived in our humanity. And yet, in all of that, he's God. Come back with me, if you will, to Colossians. He's not simply a man. He's truly, fully, completely man. He enters into everything that you know, you experience. And yet he entered into it as the God-man. And that's the fascinating, that's what makes him unique. It makes him inexplicable, except to the eye of faith. It makes him somebody to, hey, I think that's how you got the joy, 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 joy down in your heart. Woo, you ever sing that? You got to be Ancient of Days to sing that. You know, I realize that, and I'm an Ancient of Days, so some of you, you know, didn't get that in your Sunday school class. But I think about that. How do you do that? That's who he is. When you think about him, you think about who he is, you think about the uniqueness of our Savior. Listen, the Lord Jesus Christ is a prize of the universe. Colossians chapter 2, verse 10, for in him, that's in Christ, dwelleth all the fullness of the Godhead bodily. And ye are complete in him, which is the head of all principality and power. Everything that is God dwells in the Lord Jesus Christ, and your completeness is in him. There's nothing you're lacking in any way, shape, or form, in any situation. Your identity is complete and full in the Lord Jesus Christ. Who of God has made unto us wisdom, righteousness, sanctification, and redemption? He's everything you'll ever need because he's the God-man. And in him dwelt all the fullness of the Godhead. Now that term Godhead, come with me to 1 John chapter 5. We use the term, it's not a Bible term, but it's a Bible doctrine. We use the term Trinity. And that's a theological term. Preachers and teachers are often happy to develop new terms to describe the teaching that they're doing, the categories of doctrine. And the idea of a Trinity in the Bible is called Godhead. 1 John chapter 5 is a verse that explains to you what the Godhead is like. 1 John chapter 5, verse number 7. Start in verse number 6, if you will. This is he that came by water and blood, even Jesus Christ. Not by water only, but by water and blood. And it is the Spirit that beareth witness, because the Spirit is truth. For there are three that bear record in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Ghost. And these three are one. And there are three that bear witness in earth. Now, if you've got something beside a King James Bible, you didn't have verse 7 in your Bible. It's called the Johnine comma. And every new Bible leaves that passage out. That's the clearest statement of the Trinity in the Bible, and they leave it out. And you say, why did they do? Why would you want to leave out 24 words out of the Scripture? I tell you, over and over, when you've got a King James Bible, you've got every verse that ought to be in the Bible in your Bible. Every verse that shouldn't be in the Bible has been left out. Every verse that should be in the Bible is there. All of the modern versions leave out verses. They actually add in some verses that shouldn't be there. When you trust the King James, listen, I had a guy just this past week email me, and he said, oh, Brother Rick, people are telling me that King James was a Freemason and that he changed the Bible and took the name of, and all kinds of stuff. He said, what's true? I said, what are they talking about? Well, when you have somebody that has an axe to grind or a doctrine they want to promote and they have to change your Bible to do it, you know what you need to do? Stick your fingers in your ear and run as far as you can until you don't hear them and you're not around them anymore. If you've got to change a Bible to get your doctrine across, your doctrine isn't worth having. Okay? Now, I say that to you all the time, but I'll say it again this morning. This passage right here is a passage that is clear as it can be It's left out of modern Bibles. It tells you, I wouldn't want to use a modern Bible. In the beginning, God created heaven and the earth. Who's God? There he is, right there. By the way, I don't want to get hung up on that. I'm going to move on, what I'm saying. But tonight in the Bible study, I'll talk a little bit more about that. The Father, the Son, and the Spirit. The proper name is the Father, the Word, and the Holy Ghost. That's the titles of the Godhead. And those three persons are one God. Now the question is, isn't that really three? Muslims say you believe in three gods. No, we believe in one God who exists in three persons. Now how does that work? You got it. You're sitting here right here. All you folks sitting here are all humans. Right? I know you might think some of you are subhuman, but you're all humans at whatever level of humanity you're at. So we're one in our humanity, but there's 150 people. You're one in your humanity. You're multiple individuals. There are 7 billion people on the earth, but we all share the same humanity, made of one blood. There's one God, one nature, one identity as God, as deity, in three people. If you can understand there's one humanity, a common humanity expressed in 7 billion people, you can understand there's one God in three people. Now, how do I know there's only three people? Because that's who the Bible says God is. So there's one deity, all the attributes, all the essence of deity, one in essence and being, but three in persons. And the Father, the Word, and the Holy Ghost are those three. Come back. Somebody says, well, that's just, come back with me and look at Isaiah chapter 48. It's important to understand who God is and how he works. Isaiah chapter 48. In the Old Testament, the idea of the Trinity is there. It's just not as expressed as clearly as in the New Testament because it wasn't necessary. Isaiah chapter 48, verse number 16. Isaiah 48, 16. You notice in verse number 12, "Hearken unto me, O Jacob and Israel, my call, my called. I am he. I am the first. I also am the last." Now, in Revelation chapter 1, Jesus Christ is called the first and the last. You're familiar with that. So here's the Lord Jesus Christ before he became man talking to Israel. Verse 16, "Come ye near unto me," unto the Lord Jesus, and "hear ye this, I," and that'll be Christ, "have not spoken in secret from the beginning. From the time that it was, there am I, and now the Lord God and his Spirit has sent me." Now you see how it says Lord God, and Lord is in first letter, cap, L-O-R-D, lowercase, and God is G-O-D. When you study your Bible, when you see that the way your translators did that, when you go back in verse number 12, well, not 12, but you get a verse like verse number 20, at the end of it says, "The Lord hath redeemed his people," and the Lord is all uppercase, upper caps. When you see in your Bible the word Lord spelled in capital letters, that's telling you that the Hebrew text is Jehovah. When you see Lord with the first cap, lowercase, that's telling you that the Hebrew word is Elohim. Adonai. God, G-O-D, is Elohim. So when you see Lord, first cap, God, when you see God spelled in uppercase letters, that's telling you that the Hebrew text is Jehovah. When you see it, Adonai, Jehovah, Lord, God, Lord, first caps, God, uppercase, that's telling you Hebrew is Adonai, Jehovah. That in your Bible is God the Father. Every time it occurs that way. So every time you see that Lord God as in verse 16, that's the Father and his Spirit. So what do you have? You've got the Word, the Lord Jesus, before his incarnation. You've got the Father, and you've got the Spirit all in one verse. See that? Verse number 17, "Thus saith the Lord," there's Jehovah, "thy Redeemer," that's the Lord Jesus Christ, "the Holy One of Israel," I am the Lord thy God. I am Jehovah thy Elohim. That's the Lord Jesus Christ. He's the Redeemer. So you've got God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, God the Father, God the Word, and God the Spirit, all in one passage right here in Isaiah. And they're functioning as one. So the idea that you have the Father, the Word, and the Spirit, that's not a New Testament revelation that just came out of nowhere. That's a consistent thing all through your Bible as God functions. And the further you come through the Bible, the progressive revelation of who God is and working. All through the Old Testament, you find two Jehovahs, especially. There are really three because the Spirit's one too. But the idea, and the one, every member of the Godhead works to glorify the other members of the Godhead. It's one of the most fascinating things in your Bible as you study it. God the Father lives to glorify His Son. God the Father believes. Look, come with me, if you will, back over to the book of Colossians. God the Father believes. If you could see the value and the glory and the splendor and the excellency in His Son, you'd love Him like He does. Colossians 1, verse 18. And He is the head of the, He, Christ, is the head of the body, the church, who is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead. Why? That in all things He might have preeminence. Why? For it pleased the Father that in Him should all fullness dwell. God the Father says, everything of value is in my Son. He's the preeminent one in my thinking. You remember what He did at the baptism of Christ? The Spirit descends from heaven, the Father speaks, and He declares to the crowd there, this is my beloved Son, in whom I'm well pleased. You want to know the one I find pleasure in? There He is, my Son. The wonderful thing about that's Matthew 3, fascinating in Luke chapter 3, when Luke records that, he doesn't say, this is my beloved, he says directly to Christ, thou art my beloved Son. In other words, God the Father has this personal, intimate communion with His Son, and His Son knows that He values Him above everything else. And then He tells the crowd that. He wants everybody to know how much He values His Son. Hebrews chapter number 1. Hebrews chapter 1. This is a verse that blows people's minds sometimes. Hebrews 1 verse 8. But unto the Son, He saith, here's God the Father talking to the Lord Jesus. This quotes Psalm 45. Thy throne, O God, is forever and ever. A scepter of righteousness is the scepter of thy kingdom. Thou hast loved righteousness and hated iniquity. Therefore God, even thy God, hath anointed thee with the oil of gladness above His fellows. Think about that. Here's God the Father saying to the Son, thy throne, O God. God the Father calls the Son God. Then He says in verse number 10, therefore God, even thy God, I'm your God and your God. God the Father calls Himself God. God the Father calls His Son God. And then He anoints Him with the oil of gladness above His fellows. In Hebrews, Acts chapter 10 says the oil of gladness above His fellows is a picture of the Holy Spirit. You got all three of them in one verse. God the Father thinks of His Son. He's as much God as I am. We share the same nature. And everything of value I see in Him. But when you do that, come with me to Philippians chapter 2. Go back there. When you honor the Son that way, who are you really honoring? Philippians 2 verse number 9. Therefore God hath highly exalted Him, given Him a name that's above every name. So God the Father takes His Son and puts His name above every name. That at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow and every tongue should confess. I'm sorry. That every knee should bow of things in heaven and things in the earth and things under the earth. And that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Why? To the glory of God the Father. You see, when you honor God the Son, who are you really honoring? You're honoring the Father because the Son did nothing but honor the Father. I come to do thy will. God the Son only did the will of His Father, so when you honor the Son, you're honoring the Father's will. You say, well, these guys enjoy one another. These guys love each other. Come with me to John 17. The night before Christ died, he prays. Religion makes the Our Father prayer in Matthew 6, the official prayer of the Roman Catholic Church in Christendom. They say that's the Lord's Prayer. That's not the Lord's Prayer. He never prayed that. Here's the Lord's Prayer. John 17, these words spake Jesus and lifted up his eyes to heaven and said, Father, the hour is come. Glorify thy Son, that thy Son also may glorify thee. Christ is going to glorify who? The Father. And the Father is going to glorify him. As thou hast given him power over all flesh, that he should give eternal life to as many as thou hast given him. Verse 4, I have glorified thee on the earth. I have finished the work which thou gavest me to do. Now, O Father, glorify thou me with thine own self, with the glory which I had with thee before the world was. Well, when you glorify the Son, who are you glorifying? You're glorifying the Father because the Father glorified the Son and the Son does the work the Father gave him to do. Verse 24, Father, I will that they also whom thou hast given me be with me where I am, that they may behold my glory which thou hast given me. For thou lovest me before the foundation of the world. They've had this from eternity past, the Godhead, the Father, the Word, and the Spirit, loved one, had a relationship of endless admiration, value, and esteem. When the Holy Spirit comes, if you go back to John 16, what's he going to do? John 16, verse 13. Howbeit, when he, the Spirit of truth, has come, he will guide you into all truth. For he shall not speak of himself, but whatsoever he heareth, he hear, that shall he speak, and he will show you things to come. He shall glorify me, for he shall receive of mine, and shall show it unto you. Now, I don't want to spend the rest of the time doing that. Tonight we'll go over some of the details of that. It's fascinating to see God the Father love his Son, God the Son love the Father, and the two love one another completely and totally. They live completely selfless life. No member of the Godhead live for himself, for his own glory, for his own interest. They all live for the interest of the others. And that's the life of God that lived in Jesus Christ that then lives in us as he lives in us. So the Lord Jesus Christ is what I call the big G God. Come back with me to Deuteronomy chapter 10. I get Deuteronomy 10 in one hand and Jeremiah chapter 10. It's important to understand when we talk about Jesus being the God-man, exactly what we're talking about. We're talking about him being the second member of the Godhead. Jeremiah chapter number 10 and Ezekiel chapter and Deuteronomy chapter 10. Get you confused? Yeah, I'm confused. I'm confused a little too. Deuteronomy chapter 10, Jeremiah chapter 10. I want you to compare two verses. Deuteronomy chapter 10, verse number 17. For the Lord your God, that's Jehovah, your Elohim, the Lord your God, that's the Lord Jesus Christ, is God of gods and Lord of lords, a great God, mighty and terrible, which regardeth not persons, nor taketh reward. Notice he's the God, big G, of the gods, little g. Now, the idea about being God, the term most high God, here's the God who is the top one of the gods. He's the big G of the little g's, okay? That term is a term of government. He is the possessor of all authority in heaven and earth. That thing we read a moment ago in Colossians about him having preeminence in all things, all the principalities, powers, might, dominions, all the structures of government that God created in the earth. And the term God and Lord have to do with him as the governor of his creation. He's the big G. Now, there are gods, little g's. That's the angelic creation. But he's the God over all of it. How do you tell the difference? Jeremiah chapter 1, Jeremiah chapter 10. Jeremiah chapter 10, verse number 11. Start in verse 10, Jeremiah 10, 10. But the Lord, Jehovah, is the true God. He is the living God, an everlasting King. At His wrath the earth shall tremble, and the nations shall not be able to abide His indignation. Thus shall you say unto them, the gods, little g, who are they, that have not made the heavens and the earth, even they shall perish. So the little g gods didn't create anything. They're created. But the big g gods, the one that created all of them. The difference between the big g god and the little g gods is they all work in the government of the universe, but the big g god is the creator. In the beginning, God created. The little g's didn't create anything. They function in the creation. Now, if you go back to Genesis 1, and I take get Psalm 33 first. You know Genesis 1. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. And the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep. And what? The Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters, and God said. In Genesis chapter 1, the Spirit of God speaks and creation comes into existence. So who creates creation? The Spirit of God. Psalm 33. Rejoice in the Lord, O ye righteous, for praise is comely for the upright. That's praise the Lord with the harp. That's Jehovah. Verse number 6. By the word of the Lord, by the word of Jehovah, were the heavens made, and all the host of them, by the breath of His mouth. So when the Spirit spoke, the Spirit was speaking the words of the Father. In other words, the Father gave the command, the Spirit goes out and is the workhorse and does the things. Creation came about at the will of God the Father. So God the Father creates. God the Spirit creates. John chapter 1. Verse 1. John chapter 1, verse 1. In the beginning was the Word. When the beginning began, He was there. And you notice the word there is capital W. When you capitalize a word, a noun like that, you make it a proper noun. That's His name. That's why in 1 John 5, 7, it was the Father and the Word. That's His proper name. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Okay, here we are. We're all humans. We was humans. And we're with one another. So if He's with God, there's God the Father, and here's God the Son. They're with each other. The Word was God. He's equal in deity attributes, essence and deity. Separate in His person. The same as in the beginning with God. Now, verse 3, all things were made by Him, and without Him was not anything made that was made. Paul says it over in Ephesians 3, 9, to make all men see the fellowship of the mystery, which from the beginning of the world has been hid in God, who created all things by Jesus Christ. By the way, the New Bibles leave that part of that verse out too. You got a new Bible. You got something inside of King James Bible. You don't know if you got God's Word, when you got it, and when you don't. The Lord Jesus Christ is the Creator. So you have all the Godhead involved in creation. Verse 14, and the Word was made flesh and dwell among us. That's why it's called the Word. And we beheld His glory, the glory of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. The title, the Word, the Lord Jesus Christ, the second person of the Godhead, is the spokesman for the Godhead. The one who's going to reveal who God is, tell us who He is, show Him to us, make us know Him. Verse 18, no man has seen God at any time. The only begotten Son, which is in the bosom of the Father, He hath declared Him. You declare Him by revealing Him. And He became flesh so you and I could know God. So we could have, here we are, humanity. Here's the Creator up here, so we can have a connection between us that's real. And that connection is the Lord Jesus Christ. He's the one that brings us together. And when you behold Him, you see the grace and truth, the essence of who God is. Come back with me, if you will. I'll tell you what, go back to Philippians chapter 2. Philippians chapter 2. When you look at these things, it's fascinating to see how these things work out in your Bible. Philippians chapter number 2 and verse number 9. Let's start in verse 5 again. Philippians 2, 5. Let this mind be in you which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God. All these things. He's a member of the Godhead. He's equal with the Father, equal with the Spirit. They all live to honor one another, to glorify each other. There's this symbiotic life of mutual admiration and love and communion in the Godhead. And the Lord Jesus Christ, he's taking nothing away from the Father, nothing away from the Spirit to be God. But he made himself of no reputation. Why? Because he chose to do the will of the Father to become your Redeemer. Took upon him the form of a servant, was made in the likeness of men, and being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself. He recognized that everything depended on the will of his Father, and he submitted himself and was obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. God commended his love toward us, and that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. God made him to be sin for us, that we may be made the righteousness of God in him. And friend, when he hung on that cross and cried, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? God the Father, God, why have you turned? You ought to cry that for eternity in the lake of fire. When he cried, I thirst, like the rich man in hell, you ought to cry that. That was you, what you deserved. And he took your penalty, he took your place, and died for your sins. That was no small thing. Here's the Creator dying for the rebel. Now, wherefore, because of that, God hath highly exalted him. Now that's the other side. There's the cross, and here comes the resurrection. And given him a name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow of things in heaven and things in earth, things under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. That's the life side, the resurrection side. Never forget, the cross answers the sin problem fully, finally, and forever. Then there's the resurrection. Listen, if you're dead, you can't get much deader than dead. You're dead to sin. You're dead in sin. You're dead. It's over. The sin question's over. You got the wonderful joy of forgiveness, full and free and forever, complete and total. You need to be confessing your sins to God every day. He already took care of the one at Calvary. But by the cross, he took care of all of your sins. But you know, when you're dead, you're just dead. You can't do much. Years ago, we had a funeral. One of the brothers died, older brothers, and we had a funeral parlor, and the place was just packed full of people. And I'm sitting there, and the guy comes and says, "We need some more chairs." And there was Franklin in the casket, and Mr. Anderson had been the guy who had always done the setup for all the church meetings. He's dead in the casket. He didn't get up and move any chairs. Some of the other guys got up and moved the chairs in. You know why? He's dead. He's gone. Dead people don't get, but you need a lot. So you have the resurrection. You have the living side. Don't forget that you're not just saved by his death. You're saved by his life. His life in Christ lives in you. He didn't set you free from your sins. I tell people all the time, we tell people the gospel, trust Christ as your Savior, and you have a home in heaven, eternal life. And it's like Trust him right now, and then, you know, see you later. When I get to heaven, I'll get eternal life. And that's not it at all. The eternal life that you get when you live in heaven, you got that the moment you trusted Christ. That life started the moment you trusted him. Not just when you go to heaven. That's great, too. That's the future, because that carcass you're living in isn't going to last forever. But that life that's yours, that resurrection life, it's yours now. What Romans 6:13 is all about. Now that passage where he's talking there in verse number 10 and 11, about every knee bowing, every tongue confessing, that's a quote. Come back to Isaiah chapter 45. That's a quotation from Isaiah chapter 45. And this is going to tell you something about how to identify who the Lord Jesus Christ is. Isaiah chapter 45. Verse 21. Tell ye and bring them near, yea, let them take counsel together. Who hath declared this from ancient time? Who hath told it from that time? Have not I the Lord? And there is no God else beside me, a just God and a Savior. There's none else, none beside me. Look unto me, and be ye saved, all the ends of the earth. For I am God, and there's none else. I have sworn by myself, the word has gone out of my mouth in righteousness, and shall not return. That unto me, I am God, I am the Savior, that unto me every knee shall bow, and every tongue shall swear. Surely shall one say, in the Lord have I righteousness and strength. Even to him shall men come, and all that are incensed against him shall be ashamed. In the Lord, in Jehovah, shall all the seed of Israel be justified and shall glory. Now notice, when he says all of that, what he says in verse number 23, that unto me, unto Jehovah, shall every knee bow and every tongue confess. What's Philippians 2 say you're going to do with the Lord Jesus Christ? Every knee bows, every tongue confesses. So if you take Philippians 2 and you say, well, who is that? And you go back to Isaiah, who is it? The Lord Jesus Christ in Philippians 2 is the Jehovah in Isaiah 45. I'm not a mathematician. I've told you many times, when I took algebra in high school, I failed Algebra 1 three times. I mean the first semester of Algebra 1. I failed it three times. I don't know why I took it the third time. I took it in summer school. It's crazy. When you make an equation, it has numbers and letters, and the letters don't spell words, I'm lost. I love geometry. I could see it. I couldn't do algebra. So when I tell you this, I'm just telling you because I was told, but I know it's true. If A equals B and B equals C, A also equals C. You with me? You understand that formula? If A equals B and B equals C, then therefore A equals C. Well, if Isaiah 45 is A and Philippians 2 is B, they equal each other, then what does A and C equal? Jesus is Jehovah. There's a study in the bookstore, and there are 20 reasons why Jesus is Jehovah. And I go through passage in Isaiah, passage in Jeremiah, passage in and you do the comparison. He's the Savior. He's the only Savior. Who's the Savior? Jesus is the Savior. He's the rock. Deuteronomy 32, he's the rock. 1 Corinthians 10, Christ is the rock. Come with me, if you will, to Jeremiah chapter 23. This is one this blows my mind, so I'll put this out. Jeremiah 23, verse 5. Behold, the days come, saith the Lord, says Jehovah, that I will raise unto David a righteous branch. So that's Jehovah God the Father saying, I'm going to raise up a righteous branch to David, this first coming of Christ, a king, shall reign and prosper and execute judgment and justice on the earth. In his days, Judah shall be saved, and Israel shall dwell safely. And this is his name whereby he shall be called. Now, Jehovah God the Father is talking. I'm going to raise up a righteous branch in David. I'm going to raise up, that's the Lord, the incarnation of Christ. Matthew 1, he's the seed of David, the book of the generation of David and of Abraham. But notice who Jehovah God the Father says you're going to call him. Verse 6, the Lord, Jehovah, our righteousness, Jehovah Tenetzkenu, one of the Jehovah titles. There's Jehovah God the Father saying, there's Jehovah God the Son. You look at that and say, whoa, that's really interesting. Here's Jehovah, says he's going to raise up Jehovah. You say, well, you see, that's one name for two different people. Because God the Father, his title is Jehovah. God the Son has a title of Jehovah. Come back with me. That would not have shocked an Israeli. It might shock you. Come back with me to Genesis chapter 18. There are many places, starting with Abraham back here, where Jehovah appears to people and talks with them. In Genesis 18, he did it in Genesis 12 with Abraham, does it in Genesis 15 with Abraham. In Genesis 18, verse number 1, the Lord appeared unto him. So when Jehovah appears to somebody, he materializes. He's right there in front of him. If you read down through the thing, he sits down and eats with them. And Jehovah and two angels come and appear to Abraham, and they talk about what's going on in Sodom and Lot's down there. And so the two angels go to Sodom to get Lot out. And Jehovah stays with Abraham as you go down through the story there. Now, come down to chapter 19, verse 24. And understand that Jehovah that was with Abraham is been talking to Abraham in chapter 18. When you come down, in fact, if you look at chapter 18, verse number 22, the men that were with him turned their faces from thence and went towards Sodom, but Abraham stood yet before the Lord. So Abraham is standing there with Jehovah, who has appeared to him in bodily form, has eaten with him, he's materialized. He's a real, it's not just a dream. Chapter 19, verse 24. Then the Lord, that's the one with Abraham on the earth, rained upon Sodom and Gomorrah brimstone and fire from the Lord out of heaven. There's Jehovah in heaven, and there's Jehovah on the earth calling down the fire and judgment from heaven. One down here is calling that one. There's two Jehovahs. One's with Abraham, one's in heaven, one's on the earth. That's not a split personality within the Godhead. That's God the Father, that's God the Son. And all through your Bible you see God the Father, God the Son, and God the Spirit. Acts chapter 5, God the Spirit is called God. You see them working together. You see them identified together. Come with me to Zechariah chapter number 12. This is one of the ones that is real pertinent to what we're talking about. Zechariah chapter 12. The burden of the word of the Lord for Israel, saith the Lord. So here's Jehovah talking to Israel, verse 10, and I, Jehovah, will pour upon the house of David and upon the inhabitants of Jerusalem the spirit of grace and supplication, and they shall look upon me, Jehovah, whom they have pierced. By the way, New Bible's changed that verse too. Just let you know that. Anyway, they shall look upon me. So who does that passage say is going to be pierced at Calvary? Jehovah. Now, if you go to John chapter 19 and you read verse 33 to 37, they quote that passage, John does, as being fulfilled at the cross. So the Jehovah of the Old Testament in Zechariah chapter 12 that says Israel's going to pierce, they're going to look upon me whom they've pierced. John 19 says that person is the Lord Jesus Christ. Come back with me to Psalm chapter 89. Psalm 89. Psalm 89, verse number 8. Psalm 89, verse 8. O Lord God of hosts, who is a strong Lord like unto thee? Or to thy faithfulness round about thee? Thou rulest the raging of the sea. When the waves thereof arise, thou stillest them. Jesus stands on the bow of that little boat and says to the waves, peace, be still. And the storm goes calm. You know why he could do that? He was the master of the waves and the sea because he's Jehovah. And he was demonstrating to those disciples who he is. He controls nature. Come with me, if you will, to Isaiah 35. And what he was doing is demonstrating that I am the Lord, your righteousness. Isaiah 35, verse number 1, the wilderness and the solitary place shall be glad for them. Verse 2, it shall blossom abundantly and rejoice even with joy and singing. The glory of Lebanon shall be given unto it, the excellency of Carmel and Sharon. They shall see the glory of the Lord and the excellency of our God. Strengthen ye the weak hands and confirm the feeble knees. Say to them that are of a fearful heart, be strong, fear not. Now watch. Behold, your God will come with vengeance, even God with a recompense. He shall come and save you. Then the eyes of the blind shall be opened, the ears of the deaf shall be stopped. Then shall the lame man leap as a hart, and the tongue of the dumb sing. And the wilderness water shall break out. That passage, right? Do you remember in Matthew 11 when John the Baptist is in jail? He's been preaching, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. The Messiah is coming to get to. I'm the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord. And he winds up in jail. Things aren't working out like he thought they were going to work out. And he sends his disciples to Jesus, and they said, Are you really the one? Or was I mistaken and we're looking for somebody else? And Jesus said, go back and tell John. And he quotes that passage. What'd you see, John? You saw the eyes of the blind see, the deaf hear, the lame walk. What did that passage tell you? When your God comes, when you see that, it's because God's here. You know what he's telling John? He said, I'm the God back in Isaiah chapter 35. It's me. You saw the things that happen when the Messiah appears. He's the healer. Come with me to Matthew chapter number 9. Matthew chapter 9. In Matthew chapter 9, the Lord Jesus Christ is in a home in Capernaum. Verse number 2, behold, they brought unto him a man sick of the palsy, lying on a bed. And Jesus, seeing their faith, said unto the sick of the palsy, son, be of good cheer, thy sins be forgiven thee. But certain of the scribes said within themselves, this man blasphemeth. And Jesus, knowing their thoughts, said, wherefore thinkest ye evil in your heart? Now think about that. He just said, thy sins be forgiven. They think, who does he think he is? He reads their mind and tells them what they're thinking. I don't know about you, but now that's not Houdini or that kind of stuff. That's God. And he just read my thoughts. You know, I think I'd be a little bit hesitant about grabbing this guy. Knowing their thoughts, wherefore thinketh ye evil in your heart? For whether is it easier to say, thy sins be forgiven thee, or to say, arise and walk? But that ye may know that the Son of Man hath power on earth to forgive sins, then said he to the sick of the palsy, arise, take up thy bed, go into thine house. And he rose and departed his house. And when the multitude saw it, they marveled and glorified God, which gave such power unto men. Now, you know why those guys were mad? Back there when it says he blasphemes, they say later on, because no one can forgive sins but God only. Jesus Christ stood there and said, son, thy sins be forgiven thee. And they said, nobody but God can do that. He's claiming, he's demonstrating himself to be God. And they said, you need me to show you that I can do it? Rise up. Why? Because he's also the healer. He's literally demonstrating himself to be who he is. He's demonstrating himself to be who all of the scriptures said he would be. He manifests the glory of the Father. The Word was made flesh and dwell among us, full of grace and truth. You know, when you describe the Lord Jesus Christ, again, you're describing the indescribable. Paul grasps the problem, 1 Corinthians chapter 2, and this is a passage that tells you how Paul thought about it. 1 Corinthians chapter number 2. He understood how difficult it is to describe who the Lord Jesus Christ is because there's things about him that you're never going to comprehend, but you can't get what's revealed. 1 Corinthians 2, verse 7, but we speak the wisdom of God in a mystery, even the hidden wisdom which God ordained before the world in our glory, which none of the princes of this world knew, for had they known it, they wouldn't have crucified the Lord of glory. There's things about the cross work of Christ, there's things about what Jesus Christ did that God didn't tell anybody about until he came to the Apostle Paul to reveal it, because if the adversary had known about the glories that he was going to accomplish through what the Lord Jesus Christ did, he wouldn't have crucified him. That's why there's the mystery of the gospel. But as it is written, eye hath not seen, nor ear heard, neither entered in the heart of man the things which God has prepared for them that love him. With your eye gate, ear gate, and your mind, your reasoning, your heart, rather, your faith, your eye, what you see, your ear, what you hear, what you think, your heart, what you believe, with your abilities to perceive, you'll never know the things God has prepared for you. But God has revealed them. Never read that without verse 10. But God hath revealed them to us by his Spirit. For the Spirit searcheth all things, yea, the deep things of God. How does the Spirit reveal them to you? He doesn't speak words into your heart. He doesn't give you inner impressions. He doesn't give you hunches and that kind of stuff. That's not God the Spirit speaking to you. That's the bad pizza you ate last night. How does God the Spirit do it? Verse 13, he tells you. Which things also we speak, not in words, which man's wisdom teacheth, but which the Holy Ghost did. There are some words that God, the Holy Spirit, has provided for you to give you the revelation of what God has prepared for you. You got it in that book in front of you. That's why it's important to know where that book, where those words are. Listen, God wrote it, preserved it for you through history, and he's even had it provided for you to put it into your language. I go, whoopee, that's good. It's worth believing. It's worth defending. It's worth resting your life on. You can rest in who the Lord Jesus Christ is. You can rejoice in who the Lord Jesus Christ is. You can luxuriate in it. You know, sometimes you just need to lay back, take a hot bath, and luxuriate. Get a bubble bath or whatever it is you like to do. You know, just enjoy yourself. Relax. God commended his love toward us and that while you're yet a sinner. I know you're not worthy. I know he knows all. He knows more about you than you know about yourself. He knows the sins in your life that you don't even recognize yet. And he said, that's why my son died for you. That's who you are in his mind. I don't know who you think you are in your mind. But if you disagree with him, you're wrong. It's a wonderful thing to have that kind of an identity. And you know, you can't get rid of it. Try as hard as you like to. And you do try sometime, don't you? He says, nothing shall separate you from the love of God which is in Christ Jesus. Nothing. Not even your orneriest moment. Not even when you stand in front of the mirror and curse yourself. God says, I still love you. I don't mean it that way. I just relax and enjoy being loved. You say, I'm not worthy. He knew that to start with. He didn't say he loved you because you're worthy. He said he loved you because that's who he is. We often, listen, my point to you this morning, let Christ be enough. Let him be everything. All the stuff. We so often run after what he's already given us. You're complete in Christ. But we run after identity. 1 Corinthians 1:30 says, who of God has made unto us wisdom, righteousness, sanctification, redemption. You already have the wisdom of God. He says, thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. You got something you face today you need to answer for. It's in that book. Get it and find it. And you say, well, I don't know what it is. Then sit down, shut up, and find it. Learn how to study it. Learn how to get into it. That's what we're here for. That's why we don't do the jitterbug Jesus stuff. My purpose is to help you to have your senses exercised to discern both good and evil, because you've used God's word enough, you've understood it enough that you have some spiritual maturity to look at things and discern how to apply it. Wisdom. Righteousness. You know you're accepted in the beloved. This is my beloved son in whom I'm well pleased. God says you're accepted in him. You're completely, that's Ephesians 1:6. The next verse says, in whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins. A lot of folks go to church to get their sins forgiven. You can't come here to get your sins forgiven. You've got to go to Calvary. But you are. You're completely, you have a complete, total righteousness in Christ. Sanctification. How often do you do what you do to have some purpose and meaning in your life? I want to be somebody. I want to have purpose. God gave you purpose. He set you apart for the purpose for which you were created in him. And he gave you redemption. That is, you're free. You've got liberty and freedom. You have life in Christ Jesus. Let him be enough. Rejoice in him. Focus your life on him. He's the celebrity of the universe. Make him the celebrity of your life, and don't forget that that's who he is. Because so often we get moved away with the bells and whistles of the world. Just remember who he is, who God has made him unto us, unto you, and rejoice in it. And as I said, go home this afternoon. Now, I don't mean go take a shower and get in a bubble bath or something physically, but spiritually. Just go sit down and enjoy who he is and who you are in him, and rejoice in it. And let him be everything. Let him be enough. Father, we thank you this morning for your love and your grace to us in Christ Jesus. And I just pray that we talk a little bit about your son, the one in whom you find all your pleasure and joy, that our hearts might appreciate him in some measure the way you do. And that we could love him the way you love him because of who he is. We thank you for the privilege of saying we love you because you first loved us. And Heavenly Father, I pray that would mean as much to us, be as real and rich to us as it is to you. In Christ's name, amen. All right.